Welcome to Mbuya Parent School and Kindergarten, situated in Kampala City with modern well-equipped facilities plus extensive playing fields and amenities. Mbuya Parent School believes that a better future lies where children know how to find and create balances in themselves and the world around them. This explains our fusion of academic subjects and co-curricular activities. There are many opportunities presented to them to flourish both in and outside the classroom.
I want to become a president when I grow up.
Me, I want to be a pilot.
I will be the best fashion designer.
Mbuya Parent School, the sky is our
limit. E-learning. My name is Kasasra Samuel. Greetings from Mbuya Parent School and myself. Today, I've come back, just like I promised you, that I will come back to share with you. So in our lesson two, before I start, I remember I left with an activity. And right about now, allow me to take you through this activity. I've been getting different feedback. You've tried to send the answers on our WhatsApp groups and other platforms. But right now, let's share it together and we see who got what and who did not get what. Our question number one was, what is tourism? This was question number one. I remember I gave you two answers. We said, in our first answer, tourism is an act of moving from one place to another place of interest for pleasure or study purpose. Remember, we also said that tourism can be defined as a way of providing services to a tourist. Those services, we said, we have transport, we have education, we have accommodation, entertainment, and so on. But for today, I brought this, and this is our answer for number one, that is tourism. Number two, how is international tourism different from local tourism? We said international tourism refers, this is when tourists come from outside countries to other countries, while local tourism is when a tourist goes to tour from one place to another in the same country. That is how international tourism is different from local tourism. With international, you have to leave your country and go to another country. But local tourism, you just leave one place to another, but in the same area or in the same country. Our number three was, mention any three activities involved in a school tour. Activities, when we are organizing tours, there are many activities that we engage ourselves in. Number one is booking tour sites. Yeah, those who were with us last year, you saw what our deputy academics did together with the whole department that was organizing the tour. You have to go to different places that you intend to visit. You can book, you know, to make arrangements with them so that when you go, you are well known to them. That's booking tour sites. Our answer number two, we have what we call collecting tour fees. This is the money that you pay. Remember when we are taking you to Hoima, Albertine region, Makshoni Falls, you paid some money. Not too much, but you paid some money. So collecting money is very important. This money is what enables you to go and tour. This is the money that we use to hire transport means or to fuel our cars and so on. So this is also another activity that we do before the tour takes place. Our answer number three, transporting children to the different tour sites. This is, we put you in the buses, they take you to somewhere. So this is also another important activity that we do, plus very many others. You can think of the rest of activities. Our number four was identify the ministry responsible for tourism in Uganda. Well, this was very important to note. Remember in the other lesson, it was our note. We say the ministry that is responsible for tourism is the Ministry of Tourism, Wildlife and Antiquities. Don't forget, Ministry of Tourism, Wildlife and Antiquities. Yes, thank you very much. I know most of you got this according to the feedback I was getting from you. Number five, suggest any two factors that hinder tourism in some countries of Africa. These are the things that affect tourism. In most cases, some countries have not developed their tourism sector because of the following factors, just as we saw in the other lesson. Factor number one, shortage of funds. This is, in other terms, we can refer to this one as poverty. Some countries don't have enough money to inject in the tourism industry, like constructing roads, you know, advertising the tourist attractions, and so on. So that's what we mean by shortage of funds. That was point number one. Another one, we can also say poor transport systems. Some countries are having poor roads. For the case in the point, we talked about the Democratic Republic of Congo, which is having a poor road network because of the tropical rainforests. So such countries cannot attract very many tourists. Why? The tourists cannot bear the poor road network, because it does not make sense for you to tour in an area. When you go back at home, you fall sick and you go to the hospital because of the poor roads and so on. So poor transport network is also another factor that hinders tourism in an area. Another point, we have political instability. Yes, this one means when there is a political unrest, when there are wars, when people are fighting each other because of political powers. It is an example that is realized in South Sudan. We've also had it in Somalia. Such countries that are having political instabilities, they are also having what we call civil wars, cannot have their tourism functioning better like other countries that are peaceful. So I hope you're following me, and I hope you've been putting down these answers. So we can also run to our number six, which is our last number. Give three ways in which tourism can be promoted in an area. How can we have our tourism in Uganda promoted? How can we develop our tourism sector or our tourism industry? The following can be done in order to promote our tourism. One, stabilizing our politics, or having, that is the political stability. We must ensure that there is peace in the country, because most tourists want peace. They want a country where they go, tour, rest, and have peace. So this is very important. If we want our tourism industry to grow, we must ensure that there is political stability. Another point, we can also say, apart from political stability, we must promote and develop our transport network. We must ensure that the roads are properly maintained. We must have good road network, we must have railway network, we must have, you know, everything that the tourists use for transporting them should be in place in order to have our tourism industry promoted and developed. Another point, we can also say good accommodation facilities. Yeah, when you talk about accommodation, our dear candidates, these are the places where the tourists sleep or where they put after touring. For example, we have things like the hotels, we have the good beaches, such facilities. They also promote tourism, because after touring throughout the day, one would wish to go in a place that is very comfortable, that is very good for him or her to rest for that very day. So our dear learners, that is what we had, and I hope you really did your best.
Two.
One.
Yes, you're most welcome once again to today's lesson. This is another lesson, our lesson two of Peace-Saving Social Studies. Today we are going to look at game parks and game reserves in Africa. I know this is not something very new. You looked at game parks in Uganda, you looked at game parks in East Africa. Yes? Yes. Your teachers of P6 and P5 taught you about game parks. But today, we're going to look at game parks in Africa. But let me inform you about this. By the end of this lesson, I expect you to have achieved the following. One, you should be able to define what game parks are. Two, you should be able to distinguish or to differentiate between a game park and a game reserve. You know, most of us use those terms interchangeably, but they are quite different. Much as they are all game, but there is a difference between a game park and a game reserve. Also, you should be able to know and maybe tell the activities that are done in the game park and the different problems that are caused by the game parks to people, and also how we can solve such challenges. People who live near game parks have encountered several challenges, but we need to know them and how we can avoid. Game parks themselves face many challenges and how they can be controlled or solved. So let's go on with our today's lesson. Let's look at the meaning of the word game park. What is a game park? A game park is a large area of land set aside by the government to preserve wildlife for public and future generation. Now, a game park is a large area. In most cases, they are large areas of land. Some people say they are gazetted. Well, it is the same as setting or being set aside. They are set aside by the government to preserve wildlife and also for public viewing and for the future generation. If those animals or the wildlife is not well kept and maybe maintained, the people who will come in the future, our grandchildren may not be able to see these animals and other components of wildlife. That's why the government sets aside these game parks to preserve such things. So that is the definition for a game park. We can also look at another definition of a game reserve. What are game reserves? Game reserves are areas of land gazetted by the government or put aside by the government for future development, e.g. expansion of a national park. Now, how is a game park and a game reserve? How are those two things different? A game park is set aside for preservation of wildlife. But game reserves, these are places that are protected, they are gazetted for future development. You know, when the game parks become few, then the government brings the game reserves and adds them on the game parks to expand and maybe increase on the number of animals that are reared there. In other words, game parks come from game reserves, but not all of them. So a game reserve is set aside by the government for future development into a game park. I hope you're following me. Thank you very much. Let's go ahead and look at other terms. Yes, our dear candidates, there is this term game ranger or game rangers. These are armed people employed in a game park or in game parks to protect wild animals against poachers. We know who are poachers. These are illegal hunters in a game park. So these people are specifically employed to promote security and protection to the animals. As you can see in this picture, they are here carrying the guns, they are having the dogs to ensure that there is security in the game park. So if I ask you tomorrow to define who a game ranger is, please be in a position to answer, because here it is. We can also look at another term, that is the game warden or the game wardens. Who are the game wardens? These are people who take care of animals in a game park. For them, their work basically is to look after animals. They move around the game park. If they find any animal that is sick, they treat it. So here they are trying to provide either the treatment, they are treating this animal, they came across it, it was sick, so here they are doing their work. So tomorrow if I ask you, give the difference between a game warden and a game ranger, please, my dear candidates, you should be able to differentiate the two. Are we together? All right, let's continue and look at other things. We have our note here. What does it say? We are saying the largest game park in Uganda is Makshoni Falls National Park. The word is Makshoni Falls National Park. We are lucky. For those who are here last year, we visited this game park here, and you know where it is. And most of the things that are there, you are able. I think we know this game park for being the best game park for the giraffes. Yes, another point is here. The largest game park in East Africa is Ruaha National Park in Tanzania. In our P5, especially to those who came from other schools, we must have learned something else. Most of the books were saying Serengeti. Well, Serengeti used to be the largest national game park, but today, the Ruaha National Game Park in Tanzania is the largest. Why? The Tourism Board of Tanzania bought the nearby swamps and added those swamps to Ruaha. And also there was a nearby game reserve known as Usangu Game Reserve in Tanzania. They were bought and added to Ruaha. Now it qualifies to be the largest game park in East Africa. Don't forget, we've not talked about Kenya. The largest game park in Kenya is the Tsavo National Game Park. Okay? Let's look at also the largest game park in Africa. The largest game park in the whole of Africa is in Namibia, Nacraf in Namibia. Or you can call it Nacraf in Namibia. So it has no harm. You can either call it Namibia Nacraf or Nacraf in Namibia. This is the largest game park in the whole of Africa. Is that okay? So I've not listed down all the game parks, but it is your duty to open the books, to make a research and find out which game parks, those of Uganda, Tanzania, Kenya, Rwanda, and so on, plus the rest of the regions in Africa. Right about now, we can also look at the importance of game parks in Africa. My dear candidates, this is not very different from tourism, because game parks are also tourist attractions. Like tourism, we can now try to compare. Game parks are very important because of the following reasons, or these are the things that make game parks very important. One, we can say they preserve wildlife for future generation. I talked about this. Those animals, especially the ones of the rare species, they are protected so that our grandchildren can see them, okay? Otherwise, if game parks were not there, if game reserves were not there, people would hunt all these animals and kill them, and our grandchildren would not get a chance to look, have a look at some rare species like lions, like the wild cats and so on, the leopards and many others. So we say they preserve wildlife for future generations. Another point, we can also say they are sources of educational information, or we can say they are used for study purposes. When we take our children and our, maybe the students from universities, secondary schools, primary, we go to them and study about different animal kinds, animal species, and other components of wildlife like plants, forests, insects, and so on, plus reptiles. So we say they are sources of education information, or they are used for study purposes. Another point or another importance, we can say, it facilitates the development of transport system. So game parks aid in the development of transport systems like EG, air transport, road transport, and so on. We have already seen that whenever we are going to game parks, the roads that are connecting different communities or the nearby areas to game parks are always developed because they must facilitate the movement of tourists into those game parks. So they promote the development of either infrastructures or we can say transport systems. Okay, thank you very much. We can look at another importance of game parks. They attract tourists who pay foreign exchange to the country. Is this understood? They are tourist attractions. And when tourists are attracted, those people come and pay money to our governments, which money is used to run our activities, the government services and so on, constructing roads, hospitals and so on. So these are the tourists who have been attracted by these animals. Can you see them? Which animal is this? Okay, thank you very much. This is an elephant. So they are here enjoying, but from here, or even before they came here, they paid money to the tourism board, and of course the government gets money and constructs such roads and other important facilities in the country. That's how game parks are very important. They attract tourists. We can also go ahead and say they provide employment to people. We looked at the other people, the game rangers, game wardens, the drivers, and so on. So can you see the game rangers once again? They are here. Maybe they found somebody moving in the game park without permission. He was either moving or hunting animals, trying to kill animals, which is illegal. So these people are employed by the government through the tourism industry, which is also facilitated by the game parks. So we can say they provide employment to people, and here they are carrying out and executing their duties as people who are employed there. Another point, you can go ahead. I think that is enough for you. There are very many. You can go ahead and look for more and more. Now, our dear candidates, game parks, these are the problems facing national parks and their solutions. These game parks are facing very many challenges. However, it is our duty as citizens of Uganda that once we realize that there is a problem, we can provide solution to it. So let's look at problems that are facing national parks and of course their relevant solutions. Problem number one is poaching. Together, poaching. Poaching, in simple terms, you can say this is the illegal hunting of wild animals in the game parks. When people go to hunt these animals, they are reducing on their numbers, which is very bad. How can we solve this issue here? So this is a problem. This is the solution. Enforcing laws against poaching. So the government must put in place strict laws, actually, that once someone is caught in a game park trying to carry out poaching, should either be imprisoned and any other way how the government can decide. So we must enforce laws and also sensitizing the public about the uses of the animals in the game park so that they stop poaching in these game parks. Let's look at problem number two, wild bush fires. Yeah, when I talk about wild bush fires, this is the fire actually that catches the game parks, and in most cases it is caused by the tourists. As they are touring, they go on smoking and begin throwing and dropping those small parts of cigarette, which causes the fire, and also some people with the wrong intentions, those with the wrong hearts, they can come and set fire to destroy the whole game park. Yet we know the game parks are the real habitats for the animals. How can we solve this? There should be firefighting equipment. The government must put in place firefighting equipment, like the detectors. Once there is fire outbreak somewhere, they should detect and people should go to put off and putting out this fire. That's how we can. And also sensitizing the tourists not to smoke and drop their cigarette once it is still lit. So that is what we can do. We have another problem here. That is insecurity. How can we fight against insecurity? Ensuring total security in African countries. Yes, people should not fight each other. We should actually fight hard not to have insecurity, because countries with insecurity, countries that are not having peace, do not attract tourists. So we should ensure total security in the African countries. If there is a disagreement, people should solve such disagreements peacefully, without engaging fights and so on. Animal diseases and vectors, or animal disease vectors. These are the vectors, the things that cause diseases to animals. It is also a big challenge because most animals fall sick in the game parks and die. How can we solve this problem here? Employing more veterinary personnel. These are the people or the doctors who are trained to treat sick animals. So the government must train very many and also employ them in the game park areas to treat animals that are sick. That's how we can go about this problem here. Another one, poor government policies. Yes, some governments don't favor game parks. Some governments have strict laws against the tourists. How can we go about this? Or which solution can we provide? Ensuring good government policies. Especially, government should come and promote tourism by putting in money, by developing roads, and so on. And also, promoting security. That's what we mean here. Okay, are we together? Well, then there is another problem here. That's a drought. Of course, this one is caused by a bad climate or poor climate. How can we go about drought? Of course, you know what a drought causes. When there is a drought, the animals don't get water, they don't get pasture. How can we solve this? Discourage deforestation and encourage afforestation. Why? We know that once we carry out deforestation, trees are cut down and a lot of vegetation, and that one will result in too scarcity of rainfall. Once we practice afforestation, these trees that we plant are going to add too much vapor in the atmosphere that result into rainfall. Are we together? Yes. I think it has been very good, and I hope you've been following. Here we come to the end, and I want to leave you with an activity. This activity, as usual, when we meet again, when I come back, I'll begin, of course, from here, and we'll go through it. But I know it is very simple. You can even answer, do what you did, and send the feedback. Just answer in your book, take a photo using mommy's phone and daddy's phone, then you can post on our WhatsApp group, and I will tell you who got what, just like I did in the previous lesson. I thank you very much for following. I remain Chakasasra Samuel. I wish you well. Bye-bye.